Welcome to another edition of Chapter One Read Aloud. All this week, I'm going to be featuring books that are going to be in our upcoming virtual book fair, which you will find out more information about in the coming weeks. But to give you a little sample of some of the books you might see in that virtual fair, today I'm going to read the first chapter of a book called Ghost Squad by Claire Bell Ortega. And it's kind of like a Coco meets Stranger Things, with a little bit of Ghostbusters in there, a nice supernatural fantasy. For Lucy Luna, ghosts are more than just the family business. Shortly before Halloween, Lucy and her best friend Sid cast a spell that accidentally awakens the malicious spirits wreaking havoc throughout St. Augustine. Together, they must join forces with Sid's witch grandmother, Babette, and her tubby tabby, Chunk, to fight the haunting head-on and reverse the curse to save the town and Lucy's firefly spirits before it's too late. Again, with the family dynamics of Coco and an action-packed adventure of Ghostbusters, Claribel Ortega delivers both a thrilling, spooky, and delightfully sweet debut novel. So here it is, Chapter 1 of Ghost Squad. Lightning struck, and a brilliant white light bloomed, illuminating the night sky outside Lucy Luna's bedroom window. 4 hours had passed since her bedtime, but the thunderstorm outside kept her wide awake. She tried every one of her abuela's tricks, including taking slow, deep breaths while focusing on the warm glow of the fireflies coming from outside her bedroom window, but nothing had worked. Lucy hugged her knees to her chest, gazing out the window. She counted the seconds between the flash of lightning and the clap of thunder, praying that it was still too far away to strike her home. 1, 2, 3, boom! Lucy threw the covers over her head with a shriek. Niña, a voice whispered. Lucy slid the blanket slowly from her face so only her eyes were exposed. The soft glow of one of her firefly family members filled the room. Mama? Lucy asked. Like water sparkling in the sun's rays, the firefly transformed before her. The translucent form rippled before becoming whole, solid. Lucy's grandmother, Mama Teresa, settled into the bed beside her. Well, her ghost did. ¿Qué te pasa, mi niña? Mama reached for Lucy's hand. Her touch was soft and warm, just like it had been when she was alive. Her voice always comforted Lucy like fuzzy socks and Dominican hot chocolate. I'm scared, Lucy whispered to her abuela. Mama brushed Lucy's curls out of her eyes and kissed her forehead before beginning to sing softly, her accent thick yet clear as the sound of rain on a metal roof. Duermase, mi niña, duermase, mi amor, duermase, pedazo de mi corazón. Mama's voice wrapped around Lucy like a wool blanket, and before the song had ended, Lucy was drifting away from the storm outside and to a place that was quiet, safe. Lucy woke the next morning to the smell of white cheese frying in the kitchen downstairs. It was still early enough that the sun was beginning to flood the sky with warm orange and yellow hues, as if erasing the dark and stormy night before. She stared up at the ceiling of her bedroom, which was covered with hundreds of stars. In the daytime, they just looked like beige stickers on a white ceiling, all running together into a big blob of nothing. But when night fell and the lights were off, an intricate galaxy of constellations extended to every corner of the room. It was like having her own little universe all to herself. Lucy's father, Simon, had helped her paint the walls of her room a seafoam blue, the color of her abuela's house in the Dominican Republic. Above her desk, Lucy had a corkboard with all her certificates from school on it, a calendar where she meticulously kept track of her homework assignments, and a pamphlet for the Luna Ghost Tour. Beside the corkboard hung a periodic table poster that had all hip-hop artists on it and a portrait. Simone Luna was what Lucy liked to call an enormous history geek. He even started his own ghost tour company in town, and people actually paid to hear him tell stories about the history of St. Augustine, Florida. He had insisted on hanging pictures of his favorite historical figures in every room of the house. Enrique wasn't the worst to get stuck with, but she would have preferred the portrait of Mirabel's sisters that was in their living room. At least it wasn't Blackbeard. Now that dude was scary looking. Though it was early, Lucy could already hear noise coming from downstairs. At first she thought it was just the sound of her dad cooking in the kitchen, but as it got louder, she realized it was, oh no, merengue music. Lucy tried to pull the blanket over her head, but an invisible hand stopped her, flinging the comforter to the other side of the room. Que linda, tía Milagros. His voice swept through in sarcasm as she surveyed Lucy's room. She wore the same curlers, face mask, nightgown, and slippers that she had died in. Everyone thinks dying in your sleep is the most peaceful way to go, but no one ever thinks about being stuck in their pajamas for the rest of their afterlife. Up, up! It's time to clean. This house is filthy. Look at this. She pointed at a small pile of clothes near Lucy's hamper and a solitary gum wrapper in her wastebasket. Tia, no, it's Saturday. Don't dead people get tired? Nobody can get as tired as you. Imagine being so young and having so little energy. At your age, I would have been already up for 3 hours. Fold that sheet, Tia Milagros pointed at the quilt she'd thrown, and she walked out of the room. Lucy snorted and put her shackles on before going downstairs. She helped clean up after breakfast. If it were up to Tia Milagros, she'd be cleaning from sunrise to sunset. Some twisted ghosts in there. I apologize for the terrible Spanish. I tried my best. I hope that you all enjoyed that chapter one, and I hope that you end up buying it or reading it from our virtual book fair, and I'll see you next time on Chapter One Read Aloud.